Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Womanish Theology, Discovering God Through the Lens of Black Girlhood by Khristi Lauren Adams. Narrated by Khristi Lauren Adams. To Mom and Dad, for teaching me, guiding me, and showing me the way. I love you. Note from the author. Sprinkled throughout each chapter of this book, you will find quotations from Black women and girls that can help capture the diversity and complexity of perspectives in womanish theology. In carrying out my research, I conducted one-on-one and group interviews via Zoom or in person to collect detailed information from each participant. The ages of the participants ranged from 10 to 70 years old, with the adult women interviewed reflecting on their girlhood. I used a semi-structured interview format to guide each conversation, which allowed those being interviewed to express their thoughts and experiences in their own words. Pseudonyms have been used to protect the privacy of those interviewed. Introduction to Womanish Theology. As though our lives have no depth and no meaning without the white gaze. Toni Morrison, The Pieces I Am. At one of my recent book talks, a woman raised her hand and asked, "What would a Black girl theology look like?" I paused to reflect on my first year of seminary, when I had come to initially learn about theology. As a young Black woman in my early 20s, I was lost in the classes because of the depth of theological knowledge my white peers seemed to have come to seminary with. They could quote Karl Barth, the well-known Swiss Protestant theologian. They were familiar with theologians like Reinhold Niebuhr, Friedrich Schleiermacher, and Paul Tillich. We learn not just about those theologians, but also about their interpretation of theological and biblical concepts. To me, this was the standard for theological thought. Older white male theologians. They were the foremost voices of this discipline. I thought white men owned theology. My early seminary experience was dominated by what Pulitzer Prize-winning novelist Toni Morrison calls the master narrative, or the ideological script that is imposed by those who are in authority. White male voices had historically framed and shaped theological study and practice. However, elective classes later introduced me to Black, liberation, Mujerista, womanist, and feminist theologies. I came to understand that marginalized voices had always been the centerpiece of Jesus' ministry. Therefore, excluding those voices as a significant source of theological knowledge is a mistake. Theologian Nancy Westfield once wrote, "Too many male scholars have been trained themselves and others, to take private, intimate ideas and experiences of their own lives and convolute them into supposedly universal truths." She references Elizabeth Dodson Gray, who believes that women name the sacred differently than men do. In introducing womanish theology, Stephanie Mitchum writes, "Theology begins not in a classroom, but in living life. This is a departure from ideas of theology as controlled by the academy. Theology is not the exclusive property of the elite. To be young, Black, and a girl is to be part of one of the most disenfranchised, socially excluded communities. Why do we exclude Black girlhood from our knowledge of God? Black girlhood is a state of existence and an interdisciplinary field whereby Black girls are recognized as experts of their own experience." Corinne Field and Lakeisha Michelle Simmons argue that little attention has been given to Black girlhood, and that distinguishing stages of girlhood, early childhood, adolescence, young womanhood, reveals how each generation first learns about race, gender, and class domination in their families, friend groups, neighborhoods, and cities. This, I argue, is also true for how Black girls learn theological concepts at each developmental stage of life. Black girls are a legitimate source of theological knowledge. When Black women reflect on their lives, many of them tell stories of faith exploration from their childhood. To be sure, many spiritually oriented Black women did not grow up in church, have had different religious and cultural upbringings, or may not have had any spiritual or religious guidance. We were not all raised in the same way. However, For a specific subset of Black women who grew up with Christian influences, theology began on the margins of Black girlhood. Concepts like prayer, scripture, justice, suffering, and the image of God were first formed in our minds as girls. Katie Cannon, who has been widely recognized as the founder of the womanist movement, once reflected on thoughts she had as a Black girl at age 3. She explains how she went to a Lutheran kindergarten where she learned the Beatitudes, the Ten Commandments, about sin, and about the love of God. She explains that while being exposed to these teachings, her young mind struggled to understand them alongside the paradox of her own context. She says, "Yet I couldn't understand, and this is a theological question at 3 years old, what Black people had done where we couldn't go to parks or skating rinks or the library." The beginnings of her womanist frameworks were formed right there at age 3. This audiobook presents a theology from Black girlhood. Womanish theology comes closest to this thought because it is a religious framework that centers the perspectives and experiences of Black women. The womanish tradition naturally assumes Black girlhood and does consider the experiences of Black girls. But I argue that Black girlhood interpretations of theology need their own category. In the preface to her 1983 book, In Search of Our Mother's Gardens, Alice Walker provides a thorough explanation of the origins of the term womanist. 1. From womanish, opposite of girlish, i.e., frivolous, irresponsible, not serious. A Black feminist of color. From the Black folk expression of mothers to female children, you acting womanish, i.e., like a woman. Usually referring to outrageous, audacious, courageous, or willful behavior. Wanting to know more and in greater depth than is considered good for one. Interested in grown-up doings. Acting grown-up. Being grown-up. Interchangeable with another Black folk expression, you trying to be grown. Responsible. In charge. Serious. Womanist comes from womanish. According to Walker, womanish, though sometimes seen as derogatory, was how Black mothers described their female children. Oftentimes, these girls were interested in grown-up doings. In What Manner of Woman, a short documentary film created by the Womanist Institute, the narrator expounds on the unique nature of the term. Taken from the Black Southern expression, you acting womanish, mamas, nanas, aunties, church mothers, and other mothers confirmed, critiqued, and challenged their girl children to ensure that they not only survived, but thrived in a world often configured to destroy their creativity, intelligence, and womanhood. Renita Weems continues that clarification, saying that womanist comes from the Black kind of Southern folklorish way of talking about you are womanish, meaning that you are fast. It means that you are bold. It means that you break boundaries. Though womanish is more of a behavioral term, I would like to adopt it for the purposes of naming this new theology, particularly since it's at the root of the term womanist. Womanist equals theology of Black womanhood. Womanish equals theology of Black girlhood. Womanish theology explores the spirituality of Black girls through various stages of childhood and adolescence. Womanish theology explores grown-up theological concepts through the lens of Black girlhood. The direct perspectives and experiences of Black girls are distinct from womanist theology simply because womanist theology is a methodological approach that centers adult Black women. Womanist and womanish theologies are naturally connected, yes, but womanish theology moves away from the adult focus. When Jesus encourages his disciples to become like children, he challenges us, his followers, to consider young people as teachers and guides who draw us closer to God. See Matthew 18, 2 through 5. Black girls help us construct how we understand theology. In the same way that girlhood studies is distinguished from the field of feminist studies, Black girlhood theology must be distinguished from Black womanhood theology. Black girls deserve their own framework for understanding God, just as adult Black women have their own perspectives. Field and Simmons have similar thoughts about the field of Black girlhood studies needing its own voice. But what about when Black girls want to define themselves as distinct from Black women? What about the moments when they push back against their elders or celebrate themselves as a new generation in rebellion against the past? Can these moments when Black girls want to be recognized as not yet women only undermine Black feminism? Or can they strengthen it by deepening appreciation for what women can learn when they listen to girls? Furthermore, womanish theology asserts that God doesn't just meet Black women as adults. For many of us, God met us in our girlhood. It was there that our theologies began to form. Black girls can only strengthen the field of theology from this vantage point. Various ideas within womanish theology will, at times, share similarities with other forms of theology. Black girls process salvation, death, service, and other theological concepts just as any other human being. What makes this theology distinct is that these ideas are from their young minds and perspectives. I believe that all Black girls carry within them a theological story. In reflecting on my own Black girlhood, I realized that the first time I was introduced to theology was not when I entered seminary. Rather, theological concepts had been introduced to me throughout my childhood and adolescence. My friend Jamar Tisby once tweeted, "Different people in different contexts ask different questions and seek different applications of theology. We need each other to do theology well." We certainly need interpretations from Black girlhood to do theology well. This audiobook will seek to answer the question that was asked of me at the book talk I mentioned earlier. What would a Black girl theology look like? I hope an understanding of Black girlhood theology will lead you, dear listener, to a deeper appreciation for yourself and your own spiritual awareness. I hope it challenges you to deconstruct your own ideas of God and self and inspires you to engage with God more authentically outside the master narrative. Finally, I hope womanish theology reminds you that Black girls are fellow image bearers, here to point us toward a better understanding of God. Chapter 1, Womanish Theology of Scripture, How Black Girls Interpret the Bible. My first encounters with God were through my foremothers, my great-grandmother, Ma Rosella, and my grandmother, affectionately known as Mama Hattie, and her identical twin sister, Aunt Mary. In the 1980s, they all lived in a one-story, three-bedroom house on Powell Drive in Rocky Mount, North Carolina. My great-uncle Bunk and my Aunt Vita lived with them. My aunts, uncle, and mother purchased and took care of the home so that the five of them could live there. My family had a tradition in which the grandchildren spent their summers down south in Rocky Mount, where at least seven of us cousins crammed into the tiny space. When I was a child, the space didn't feel so tiny to me. It was like a never-ending maze that could hold the entirety of our collective family. The house was more than just a house. It was home. That was how we would refer to it when we spoke of visiting. If my mother said, "We'll be heading home for the holidays," she didn't mean our New Jersey house. She meant the house on Powell Drive. When my family went down south, we always drove. My mom and dad would pack the car with our suitcases, snacks, and sandwiches. My older brother and I would sit in the back seat prepared for the long drive that took only about 8 hours but felt like days. When we reached the exit for Rocky Mount, I would feel myself getting more and more excited. Passing the old Belk department store, the Piggly Wiggly, and the Gardner's barbecue restaurant meant we were getting closer to home. I knew we were just minutes away when we passed Holloman's because the convenience store was about 2 blocks from where we would turn onto Powell Drive. As the car pulled up to the house, my brother and I would boil over with excitement. My dad would barely have taken the keys out the ignition before I opened the car door and ran up to the house and through the front door. Just inside the house was the main living room, which was spacious and bright. Each area had its own unique smell. The living room smelled of lint balls. A plastic-covered sofa sat against the wall facing the front door. They had the plastic on the couch to keep the good furniture from getting dirty. A table sat against the front window that we knew to be a special table because on it sat a large white Bible that was described as the family Bible. Next to it were pictures of my family and a piece of art that had the word Yahweh written in Hebrew on it. A portrait of Martin Luther King Jr., another of Black Jesus, and a rendering of the 23rd Psalm hung on the walls of the living room. The living room was not for frivolous play. It was a space to entertain special company. We didn't just hang out in the living room, and if we did, we got in trouble. There was always an abundance of snacks waiting for us in the dining room. Pork rinds, Little Debbie zebra cakes, oatmeal cream pies, cookies, and candy. The freezer was stocked with ice cream and ice pops that my grandfather, Granddaddy Joe, would bring by. He lived in another part of Rocky Mount. Through the dining room was the den, which functioned as an alternate living room, where all of us hung out leisurely. At any given time, 20 of our family and close family friends were in the home at once. When I entered the house after the long drive down, I would run straight into the kitchen to be greeted by Mama Hattie, who was usually there preparing a meal for us. The kitchen often smelled of pies baking or chicken and dumplings on the stove. If we were visiting around the holidays, stacks of sweet potato pies would be waiting for us on the counter. "Hey, sugar," Mama Hattie would say when she saw me, her face glistening with sweat from standing over the hot stove for hours. She would wrap her arms around me, swallow up my small body, and kiss my face a few times. She was home. I was home. Godly is the word I use to describe my grandmother. She was the first person to introduce me to the faith. I knew her to be the main caretaker for me, my brother, and my cousins when we spent the summer in Rocky Mount. I spent a great deal of time with Mama Hattie, so I got to watch her closely. Like with the home, I can picture her vividly. I can see her sitting in her room on the front corner of her bed, leaning toward a side table with a small lamp on it. I can even see what she was wearing. She often wore a thin white robe with small buttons in the front, and what looked like splashes of colors, either flowers or butterflies. Most importantly, I can see that she is reading her Bible, held with such love and care. She would often spend the morning sitting on the corner of her bed, quietly reading, wearing large oval reading glasses. We all understood that this was sacred time, and she was not to be disturbed. I would sometimes sit on the opposite side of the bed and watch her. Although she wouldn't acknowledge me until she was finished, she knew I was observing. Sometimes when she wasn't in the room, I would go in and take a sneak peek in her Bible. It was big for my small hands and the cover was worn. The first page read, "The Holy Bible," giant print, King James Version containing the Old and New Testaments, red letter edition. On another inside page was Rosella Rogers, written in cursive. This Bible had been passed down from her mother, my great-grandmother, Grandma Rosella, who also lived in the home. Within the pages of scripture were notes in the margins, "By faith and not by sight," one margin read. Scripture passages like "Wait on the Lord" were double underlined and the word "wait" was circled. I didn't quite understand what any of it meant at the time. I just knew that this was a very important book and that it was from God. Mama Hattie believed in the authority of scripture. To her, scripture was like medicine. Scripture had the power to heal. The words were meant to be applied daily to keep us on the right path. I believe this is the reason Mama Hattie, Grandma Rosella, and Aunt Mary were intent on passing down scripture to all of us. To this day, my mother still owns that Bible. It was Mama Hattie and not the church that taught me some of the foundational Bible songs. When it was bath time or play time, she would sing the songs and have me repeat after her. I knew that Mama Hattie believed the lyrics she sang to me, And because of that, I trusted the words too. When I reflect on this, I realize those songs were all interpretations of scripture. I was learning the Bible through the lyrics to the songs. "He's got the whole world in his hands" is a reflection of Psalm 24, 1 through 2. "The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers." English Standard Version. This little light of mine is about Matthew 5:16. "In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven." English Standard Version. The song "Jesus Loves Me" is explicit that Jesus loves us. How do we know? For the Bible tells me so. Mama Hattie took us to church every Sunday. Sleeping in on Sunday mornings was never an option for anyone in our household or any of our neighbors' households. I wore frilly dresses and patent leather shoes. My brother and male cousins wore suits, and Mama Hattie would have on a dress with a glorious, wide-brimmed church hat to match. We would all pile into her old wood-paneled station wagon to take the 10-minute drive to Ebenezer Baptist Church. Though I didn't know what a megachurch was at the time, Ebenezer felt like one to me. The large brown brick building sat at the end of the first section of Raleigh Road. There was an Ebenezer Baptist Church sign, and the pastor's name, Reverend Thomas L. Walker, was directly underneath. As we walked into the church, we were always greeted by friendly people, all who knew Mama Hattie and the Clark family by name, even if I did not recognize them. In the church lobby, I was always met with cool air and an ambrosial smell that was so distinct that it continues to be difficult to describe, and I have only ever associated it with Ebenezer. The choir was usually singing, or someone would be up front at the altar praying as we entered the sanctuary. Typically, my brother and cousins would go off to Sunday school, and I would stay with Mama Hattie. As a young girl, I could not comprehend what was happening and would lean over to ask Mama Hattie to explain. One time, as the communion plate was going by, and I asked her why I could not take communion like everyone else, Mama Hattie explained to me that I had to be saved and baptized to take communion. In the Baptist church, unbelievers could not take communion. I wanted to be baptized, but then I was told that I was too young to understand. I remember hoping that nothing would happen to me before I was old enough to get baptized, because I did not want to die as an unbeliever. Yet I was confused because I did believe as I had been taught. The pastor, Reverend Walker, would walk to the pulpit during the middle of the service. Reverend Walker was a black man with a very distinctive and commanding presence. He always wore a black and red cape over his suit and shook hands with anyone already behind the pulpit before kneeling to pray at the large chair in the middle and taking his seat. He had a slow, deep, raspy voice that would oftentimes rise as the congregation would yell, "Yes," and "Amen, Pastor," throughout the sermon. The message he preached always found its sole source in Scripture. From time to time, Mama Hattie would lean over to see if I was understanding. For the most part, I did not understand, but she would explain as much as she could. At the end of the sermon, Reverend Walker would always sing his signature song, "One Day at a Time." "One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you." I heard that song so much that one Christmas I asked my parents for the vinyl record that Reverend Walker and his ensemble recorded that included that song. Upon receiving it, I played it repeatedly on my record player over the next few months. When we stayed in Rocky Mount for the summer, the seven of us cousins would sit around the table for every meal. At the center of the table was a plastic box shaped like a loaf of bread. It was labeled with the words, "Our Daily Bread." And in the box were different verses from the King James Version, written on small rectangular cards. If one of us touched our meal before we read scripture, we would get in trouble in the form of a slight tap on the hand or a reprimanding glance. Mama Hattie would have us pass around the small box and take out a scripture passage at random. When we were done, each of us would take a turn reading. This household practice went on every day for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. John 6:51, my brother Sean would read, "I am the living bread, which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." My cousin Tara would read Psalm 19:14, "Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer." Because I was so young and newer to reading, I would read at my own slow pace. Proverbs 3:5. "Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding." Reading the scripture was not enough. Mama Hattie would ask us what it meant to us. I would interpret the scripture the best I could from my childlike perspective, and even if I was far off topic, Mama Hattie would say there were no wrong answers. She taught us to interpret the words the best we could for ourselves, an integral approach to hermeneutics, which deals with methods.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.